Haley was begging Gwen to let go of Mark. However, Gwen had come to the hospital with a game plan. She spoke in a pitiful tone. "Haley, I wish I could fulfill this wish of yours. It's not that I want to be with Mark, but I'm already carrying his child. Do you want our child to grow up without a father? Please consider this as me begging you to leave Mark. I know you've had a relationship with him for several years, but you haven't had a child with him all this time. If you truly love him, you should step aside and allow me and this baby to have a future." Tori had analyzed Haley's motives during their previous encounter, so she had trained Gwen on how to handle someone as shrewd as Haley. Gwen knew she needed to control her temper. The angrier she got, the more she would inadvertently assist Haley. At that moment, all Haley could hear was a deafening roar in her head. She had a child? Haley mechanically turned to look at Mark. "Mark, is what she said true? You and her?" "I'm sorry, Haley. She and I had an unexpected one-night stand," Mark replied, unsure of the truth behind the child's claim. However, it was a fact that he had been intimate with Gwen. "How could you do this to me, Mark? How could you?" Haley flung her arms, hitting him and venting her frustration. Meanwhile, Gwen quietly smiled, satisfied with the outcome. Her mother was right. Haley couldn't conceive a child on her own. Using the child to provoke her was the best strategy. Mark retorted, "Haley, there are reasons behind all this. I never wanted it to be this way. Haley, you're a beautiful woman. You can pursue any man you like. Mark has already made up his mind to marry me. It's even been announced to the media. There's no turning back now. Please, if I beg you, consider helping our family. We will definitely repay you with gratitude." Gwen seized the opportunity to persuade. Haley's face was twisted with anger. Gwen had managed to seize the trump card with a child. Haley's expression was blank as she started to unravel the situation. She was wondering how the situation got so out of control. She couldn't compete with a woman who was pregnant with Mark's child. Gwen, too, seemed to have changed her temperament overnight. She looked at Mark with unfocused eyes. "We were supposed to be a family. Mark, what have I meant to you all these years?" she croaked. "Gwen, that's enough," Mark scolded Gwen, clearly understanding what she was trying to do. Gwen looked apologetic. "Haley, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to hurt you. It's just that the situation in front of us is unavoidable with the baby. I've already found two nurses to assist you. If you need anything, you can reach out to them." Mark's work is incredibly demanding, and it's unreasonable to constantly expect him to be by your side. If you genuinely love someone, you should allow them to prioritize and move ahead in their life. Mark found himself in an uncomfortable position, torn between two women. Recent events had taken a toll on him both physically and mentally. Checking the time, he realized it was getting late, and he still had a lot of work to attend to at the company. Balancing the demands of Gwen, Haley, and even Harry, who had been showing interest in him, left him with little time to rest. He stood up, straightening his attire. "Gwen, let me make this clear. If you dare to harm or hurt Haley in any way, I won't forgive you," he announced. "Mark, I understand my mistake from yesterday. After all, Haley is someone you love. I will treat her well from now on. I know this news came as a sudden shock to Haley, and I can empathize with her," Gwen urged him. Mark nodded. "I'm glad you realize that. Haley, get some rest. I'll visit you after I finish my work." He hurriedly left, feeling a heavy weight on his shoulders. The recent events had taken a toll on his spirits, leaving him feeling downcast. As soon as Mark departed, Gwen's demeanor swiftly changed. Her obedient facade vanished, and a different side of her emerged. Meanwhile, Tori sat beside Haley, appearing like a friendly neighbor. Her voice exuded kindness. "Haley, you heard it yourself. Mark and Gwen are going to get married. You've been by Mark's side for so many years, but even if you continue to follow him, you won't gain anything. Women need to plan for their own futures. I've been through similar experiences, so I understand your pain. Every woman desires to marry into a wealthy family, and Barclays perfectly fit that criterion. You have been striving so hard, but this seems like a dead end. Please don't get me wrong. I'm not mocking you, Haley. I'm simply helping you see the bigger picture. You can't have children, and you lack a prominent family background. If Mark truly wanted to marry you, he would have done so long ago. Things wouldn't have reached this point. You're still young and beautiful, What's the use of staying by Mark's side for all these years? Women are like candles. Once they burn out, a gust of wind can extinguish them. You'll be left with nothing. I believe you're a smart person. Haley, you should know what your best choice is. If you break up with Mark now with your looks, you'll soon find someone even more suitable for you. If you trust me, I can help you find someone who is on par with him. Furthermore, if Mark is caught between you and Gwen every day, ultimately, he's the one who will end up suffering the most, won't he? I've heard that Mark's cousin Harry Barclay has also returned. He aims to compete with Mark for control of the Barclay Group. All this is already stressing out Mark. The fact that Mark has liked you for so many years shows that you're a gentle and virtuous person. If you take a step back and allow Gwen and Mark to build a relationship, I think everyone will be grateful to you. We'll all appreciate it. Haley let out a sigh in response to Tori's eloquent words. Tori had painted a rosy picture of how things should go. It looked like Tori was far smarter and shrewder when compared to Gwen. But Tori's expectation for her to let go so easily showed how little she thought of Haley. Mrs. Jenner, your words sound pleasant, leaving no room for argument. But I have a question for you, Haley spoke up. Tori maintained her smile. Please go ahead, Haley. Haley countered. If you can find a man who is equal to Mark, why don't you introduce him to your own daughter? Instead, you're encouraging her to be the third wheel in someone else's relationship. Don't you fear the consequences of such actions? Tori's smile froze on her face. It was evident that this girl was not someone to be underestimated. Gwen turned to face her and said, Haley, why are you so shameless? Mark can't marry you, so why are you clinging to him for no reason? What exactly are you trying to achieve? A woman's marital status is more important than anything else in this society. You'll never attain that title. Haley couldn't help but chuckle. Gwen's reasoning was baseless and lacked understanding. Gwen laughed mockingly in response. You claim that you and Mark truly love each other? Haley, you're living in a dream. I admit that Mark doesn't have feelings for me, but do you know why I managed to get into his bed? Gwen, Tori coldly rebuked when she heard Gwen's bold words. Mom, what are you so afraid of? There's no one else here anyway. If I decide to talk about it, I will. What is there to fear? Gwen snapped as Haley tightened her grip on the blanket. In all honesty, what she wanted to understand the most was how Mark, who seemed to despise Gwen, could have been intimate with her. Gwen was undeniably beautiful, but that might not be the sole reason. Mark wasn't someone who prioritized appearances in the first place. With his status, he wouldn't have encountered many beautiful women trying to seduce him over the years. It wasn't just a matter of him being cautious. More importantly, Mark had always been principled and disciplined, never engaging in promiscuous behavior. That was why Haley couldn't bring herself to let go of Mark. Where could she find another man as exceptional and virtuous as him? Initially, she had doubted that anything had happened between Mark and Gwen, but Mark himself hadn't denied it. It was clear that it was the truth. Why? Haley asked coldly. If Mark didn't want to provide an answer, she could coax one from Gwen. Gwen smiled. It's quite simple. The person Mark likes is my sister Serena. That night on the cruise, I used Serena's phone to lure him to me. I also obtained Serena's room card. Mark believed I was Serena, and it didn't require any effort on my part to succeed. Haley, let me tell you something. That night, while he was with me, he kept calling me Serena. He treated me with so much care. It proves one thing. He doesn't have any feelings for you. It has been Serena all along. You're talking nonsense. Mark loves me, Haley gritted. Among all the hurtful words that Gwen had uttered, this one stung the most. She recalled Mark's strange behavior during this time. The last time they had been intimate was in London when Mark discovered another man in Serena's room. That was why he had been intimate with her. Haley couldn't believe this reality. She had been together with Mark for years, while he had only known Serena for a few months. How could he suddenly fall in love with her? Gwen had only used this revelation to provoke Haley, but she didn't anticipate it to have such a profound effect. She was not done. Then explain to me why he got intimate with me that night. If he truly loved you so much, why would he get into bed with someone else? She demanded. Haley's eyes were filled with frustration and disbelief. Do you have any idea how many times he made love to me that night? He was tender and gentle. The more I think about it. Tori couldn't bear to listen any longer. She nudged Gwen to shut up. She had only intended for Gwen to provoke Haley, but she hadn't anticipated her daughter revealing such details. Haley struggled to regain her composure. You're lying to me. You're fabricating stories. Do you think you can force me to let go just by saying these things? Let me make it clear, I will never let go of Mark, no matter what you say. Your words are meaningless. Even if I can't prevent your marriage, Mark will never treat you as his wife. If you want to be alone in your room every day, I'll make sure you experience it, Haley declared with determination. Gwen didn't expect Haley to be so stubborn. Haley, you lack propriety. If you want to play games, go ahead. We'll see if you have the means to play with me, she growled. Haley glared at Gwen. Gwen, you initiated this conflict. I'll go all the way to the end with you. The two women had locked horns, unwilling to back down. Gwen proclaimed, Fine then. At the end of the month, I'll have a wedding with Mark. I hope it won't be too painful for you. Haley refused to back down, stating firmly, Gwen, I can't guarantee that I won't come and cause a scene. I'll make sure your wedding is a memorable one. Gwen responded coldly, Don't forget that Mark and I are on the same side now. If you create a scene, it will affect Mark as well. Think about it. Haley's deep affection for Mark became her vulnerability, and Tori saw an opportunity. She took out a check and presented it to Haley. Haley, given the current situation, it's time for you to let go. Even if you fight for it, how many more years can you hold on? Even if it's not Gwen, do you think the Barclay family won't pressurize Mark to remarry? A future between you and him is impossible. It's better for you to face this reality sooner rather than later. Here's $1 million. Take it. I'd rather be friends than enemies with you. Haley looked at the $1 million check and smirked contemptuously. Seems like the rumors about the Jenner family's finances are true after all. The monthly allowance Mark gives me surpasses this drop of water in the ocean. Without hesitation, Haley tore the check in half. Mrs. Jenner, how about I give you $2 million and you make Gwen leave Mark? Gwen yelled at her. You shameless woman. You're too stubborn. You don't want this million. From now on, you won't receive a single cent from Mark either. Mom, let's go. Left alone in the ward, Haley gazed at the morning sunlight streaming through the window. She reached out to touch it, but it slipped through her fingers. The sky darkened in a moment, complimenting the mood. With her face covered with hair and her head hung down, she muttered, This is nonsense. Mark would never fall in love with anyone other than me. I know it. Gwen must have deliberately provoked me to say these things. Mark wouldn't, absolutely wouldn't. As she thought about it, tears flowed down her cheeks. On the other hand, Gwen, annoyed after the confrontation with Haley, remarked, Mom, Haley is practically indestructible. She doesn't respond to kindness or toughness. Once Mark and I are married, what will I do if she continues to cling to him? Now you realize how tough it is? I already told you, but you chose not to listen, Tori replied sarcastically. However, Gwen refused to give up. Mom, don't be sarcastic. I refuse to believe she has no weaknesses. You said she's not exceptionally beautiful, and her family background is nothing great either. Why has Mark always treated her so well? There must be something else to it. Tori pondered for a moment. What you're saying makes sense. Mark's excessive doting on her is indeed questionable, she muttered. Mom, contact a top-notch private investigator. I need to uncover the truth, Gwen insisted. Remember what I told you. Be gentle in front of Mark. Don't confront Haley directly. First, we need to appease Mark. And yes, we have to arrange the wedding as soon as possible. That's when you'll truly become Mrs. Barclay, Tori stated. Even if problems arise in the future, if you two decide to divorce, you can secure a substantial settlement from Mark. With the Barclay Group's current success, acquiring some shares will save the Jenner family. Serena is selfish. I only have you as a daughter. You must repay the Jenner family generously in the future. I understand, Mom. I put so much effort into seducing Mark. I won't let this big catch slip away so easily, Gwen said, a lazy smile crossing her face. The rain had been pouring heavily lately, and the temperature was dropping. Leo gazed at the gloomy sky outside, indicating that it would be another rainy day. Observing Serena wearing just a shirt, he retrieved a sweater from the wardrobe. The temperature today is a few degrees lower than yesterday. You should layer up. Serena was sitting calmly, but her eyes revealed hesitation. Leo, I feel so happy. Serena lowered her head and fiddled with Leo's clothes. If you're truly happy, then why are your eyes telling me the opposite? Leo questioned. Serena muttered, I can't help but feel that my happiness comes at the cost of Mark's suffering. Dealing with Haley and Gwen won't be easy. My conscience troubles me. Leo let out a helpless sigh. His beloved was too kind-hearted. Silly girl, I've told you numerous times that Mark can handle it. Don't worry about that, just relax. Leo gently caressed Serena's hair, as if soothing a child. Even though Serena claimed to be fine, she carried a heavy burden in her heart. Her happiness today was intertwined with Mark's well-being. She felt indebted to Mark. The more she reveled in joy, the more anxious she became about Mark's situation. It was characteristic of her childlike nature that Leo had noticed from the very first day they met. Therefore, he had no choice but to distract Serena's attention by comforting her each day. Baby, our wedding is scheduled for next month. The topic abruptly shifted to the wedding, leaving Serena stunned. Isn't next month a bit too soon? She asked. Leo chided. I actually think it's a bit late. I've been eager to declare that I'm married to you. You can decide where to hold the wedding, and I can arrange for people to make the preparations. Even up until this moment, Serena found it somewhat surreal. Reflecting on how she had to hide and keep their relationship a secret before, now she could finally stand proudly by his side. She got a bit emotional. Why are you crying again? Leo's heart ached as he squatted down and cupped her face. Don't you want to marry me? Serena shook her head. It's not like that, I'm so happy. Leo, I can finally marry you, she croaked. Leo questioned. You silly girl. Then why are you so upset? Serena suggested. No, I am fine. Let's have the wedding here in America. Going overseas would be too troublesome. Serena was still considering Leo's convenience. Holding the wedding abroad would incur more expenses. Leo was wealthy, but she didn't want him to spend money unnecessarily. The larger his company grew, the more responsibilities he had, so there was no need to burden him with unnecessary expenses. Leo agreed, I'll do as you say. Marriage only happens once in a lifetime. You can choose whatever you want and you don't have to worry about anything else. Serena smiled. Then it's done. We will have the wedding right here. Okay, Peach, your wish is my command. Leo always unconditionally followed Serena's decisions. He believed that she had endured a lot on her journey. Now he would make sure to provide everything for her. Leo glanced at the rain outside, feeling relieved that there hadn't been any thunderstorms recently. He had always harbored doubt in his heart. Since his mother and aunt had both died in the fire, he should be more sensitive to fire-related situations. So why would he get out of control on a rainy night? Leo couldn't help but wonder what had happened on that stormy night when he was 5 years old. He had already dispatched people to investigate his mother's past, to uncover the identity of his father. Why did his mother return with him instead of staying with his father? If his father had abandoned his mother, why didn't she hold any resentment towards him? It had been so long ago, and he didn't have many useful leads to follow. So far, there were no significant breakthroughs. He turned to Serena. Serena, I heard that the Jenner family once had twin sisters. They were your father's sisters, right? He asked. Since his mother had passed away before she was born, Leo wondered if she had heard about them. Serena said, Oh, I think so. When I was young, I overheard my grandparents talking about it once. I asked them about it at the time, but they seemed reluctant to discuss it further. Unfortunately, my grandparents passed away early and I never heard anything more about them. What about your father? Didn't he mention anything? Leo asked, and hoped to find a lead at least through the Jenner family. Serena pondered for a moment. He might have mentioned them, but I'm not sure. I vaguely remember having two aunts. Oh, I recall when I was young, I was playing in the old family manor and accidentally stumbled upon their room and saw a picture. They were both very beautiful. Grandpa and Grandma said they passed away a long time ago. I remember feeling saddened that such beautiful people had died at such a young age. Leo's eyes gleamed with hope. The old Jenner family house? Take me there. Take, I'd like to have a look. He had hit roadblocks with the investigation about his parents and his past. He had hoped if he visited the Jenner family residence, perhaps he would find some clues. Even if it didn't work out, he still wanted to see the place where his mother grew up. Serena looked at him in confusion. Leo, why are you so curious about my aunts? She questioned. Leo explained, someone close to me mentioned that you had twin aunts who died at a young age. I'm just curious about their untimely deaths. Serena admitted her own suppressed curiosity about the matter, but had been too afraid to ask her grandparents. Trusting Leo completely, she agreed to accompany him. Leo, however, kept his true motive hidden from Serena. He didn't want to risk losing her. As they arrived at the old Jenner family residence later, they discovered a surprising scene. The once empty courtyard was now bustling with people taking measurements. Tori, enthusiastically promoting the property, exclaimed, "Our house is spacious. If you buy it, you won't regret it." Serena recalled her grandfather mentioning that the Jenner family lived in this humble brick house before their rise to wealth and the construction of their grand villa. Now, the Jenner family's declining finances were leading them to sell their ancestral home. Sean, wearing a pained expression, carried the weight of the family's downfall. He had failed to protect the family business and now couldn't even keep their house. The sadness in his eyes was obvious, reflecting the rapid deterioration of his family's fortunes. Initially, the family's problems were like minor ailments that could be easily treated. However, they slowly escalated, snowballing into a much larger crisis. The situation continued to worsen with each passing year, reducing the Jenner family to a mere shell of its former self. It seemed as though invisible forces were pushing everything into darkness. The family was burdened with numerous external debts, and the company had lost 2/3 of its investors. The company teetered on the brink of collapse, with the looming threat of bankruptcy. Left with no other options, they reluctantly heeded Tori's advice and decided to sell the family's villa and land in a desperate attempt to alleviate the pressing circumstances. Serena, taken aback by the scene unfolding before her, stepped forward, her emotions flaring. "What on earth are you doing?" she exclaimed. Tori, assuming Serena had come to stake a claim on the family property, responded with hostility. Her goodwill towards Serena had long faded. Selling the house. "Can't you see? Serena, since you've chosen to abandon our family, don't expect to receive a single cent from us in the future," she snapped. Tori believed Serena had heard rumors and had come to fight for her share. Her intentions were far from benevolent. Who said anything about money or inheritance? "This is the place where our grandparents lived their entire lives. It holds significance for our family," Serena retorted, her anger escalating. Had she not coincidentally arrived here today, she would have been oblivious to Tori's audacious actions. "Are you trying to compensate for the company's losses by selling our ancestral home? Even if the company is struggling, you can't sell this property," Serena commanded. Tori brushed Serena off and directed her attention to the prospective buyer, pulling them aside. "Pay no attention to her. Let's continue our discussion. Are you satisfied with the price I quoted?" she questioned. "$20 million is too steep. The location isn't particularly desirable, and the house is showing signs of age. If I were to buy it, I'd have to spend additional money on renovations." Tori clenched her teeth. "Then what price do you have in mind?" she snapped. Ultimately, selling a property hinged on its location. As this wasn't a prime city center location, the price couldn't be inflated. "I can offer a maximum of $15 million. We have a history of friendship after all." Tori hesitated, caught between her desire for a higher price and the urgency of the situation. "For $20 million. "I'll buy it," declared Leo in a cold, unwavering tone. He refused to let his disdain for the Jenner family sway his decision. His mother was a Jenner. If she were present, she would likely oppose the hasty sale of her family's ancestral property. Tori looked at Leo in surprise and questioned, "Why do you want to buy this house?" From Tori's perspective, Leo had no need for another house. He was currently residing in a grand villa. "That's none of your business." "Are you selling it or not?" Leo asked. and avoided revealing the fact that he had Jenner family blood running through his veins. "Well, if you are buying, it will cost at least $30 million, Tori replied. Since Leo had come forward and proposed the idea, Tori saw it as an opportunity to inflate the price. She was an expert at exploiting situations for personal gain. When Serena heard Tori's words, her anger flared. "How can you stoop so low?" she gritted. It was only now that Serena realized how much she underestimated Tori's shamelessness. If a woman could use her own daughter as leverage for money, selling ancestral property should be easy on her conscience. Not only that, Tori had the audacity to raise the price since Leo showed interest. On the other hand, Tori showed no remorse. She smiled and replied, "Why? What's wrong with me?" Serena was fuming. "You are from the prestigious Jenner family. It's bad enough that you're not protecting the family's ancestral legacy, and now you want to profit from its sale." "What legacy? How does it matter? Dead people can't eat anymore. Why should I care?" Tori retorted, showing no remorse. "Serena, let me tell you something. Even if you try to sever ties with the Jenner family, it won't change the fact that I raised you all these years. If your husband can afford the $30 million, it's his. Otherwise, I have a buyer ready for $15 million, Tori threatened. Serena, fearing that Leo would fall into Tori's trap, quickly held his hand and pleaded, "Leo, don't buy it, you ungrateful girl." "If I had known this earlier, I..." Tori's words trailed off as she abruptly stopped herself. Leo spoke in a cold tone, "Then sell it to someone else." Tori had hoped to extort money, but she hadn't anticipated Leo's refusal to purchase. Her expression turned ugly with anger. "Then I hope you don't regret it, Mr. Damon." Serena turned her gaze toward Sean and spoke with a hint of resignation. "How are you letting her sell the family's property? Today she is selling the old residence, but what will she sell tomorrow?" "Serena, it's not your mother's fault that she is this adamant about selling the house. Our family's situation is dire." "We have no other choice," Sean replied, wearing a pained expression. Serena grumbled. "She's not my mother. I don't want a mother who values money above everything else." Tori had once again crossed a line in Serena's presence. Serena couldn't fathom having a mother like her. Although Serena had expressed her desire to distance herself from the Jenners, deep down, she didn't want to see the old family house being sold. Leo softly reassured Serena, gently patting the back of her hand. "Don't worry." However, Serena was unwilling to let Tori take advantage of the situation and make Leo spend millions without any valid reason. She wondered if Leo had a solution. What could he do? Tori and Alex Martin signed the agreement. They both were discussing the details of the building when Leo interrupted with a cold tone. "Mr. Martin, can we talk?" With Leo's identity being widely known due to media attention, everyone in the industry was wary of him. "What can I do for you, Mr. Damon?" Alex Martin was a real estate businessman. Leo proposed, "I will not take much of your time. I would like to discuss the probability of selling this house to me for $20 million. Even if Leo had proposed to Alex Martin a proposal for $15 million, he would have agreed. Leo deliberately increased the price by $5 million just to provoke Tori. Tori understood that Leo had no intention of giving the extra money to the Jenner family. Alex Martin saw the opportunity to earn an extra $5 million without much effort, which was more profitable than any business deal. "Mr. Damon, your generosity is appreciated. If you desire this house, I'm willing to sell it to you at the original price I am purchasing." Leo smiled and said, "No need. I insist on $20 million. Alex was happy with the fastest money he had ever made. "Thank you very much, Mr. Damon." Tori was on the verge of exploding with anger. "Leo, you're intentionally making things difficult for me, aren't you? Fine, I'll sell it to you for $20 million. Alex quickly seized the opportunity. He couldn't let such a lucrative deal slip away. "Mrs. Jenner, haven't we already signed the contract? This property now belongs to me, doesn't it? Whether it's business or anything else, honesty is paramount." "Alex, we haven't completed the formalities yet. Leo is my son-in-law. Our relationship is just..." Tori hesitated. Tori's behavior disgusted Serena once again. She was very cunning and shrewd when it came to money. Leo remarked, I'm sorry, but I recall that Serena and the Jenner family have already cut ties with each other. If she is not your daughter, how can I be your son-in-law? Moreover, you have already signed the contract. Now the ownership of the house belongs to Mr. Alex Martin. I only acknowledge him and will deal with him. Leo didn't show any leniency towards Tori, her face contorted in anger. Alex said, Mr. Jenner, let's complete the rest of the formalities now. Leo, Serena, just wait and watch. You will regret doing this to us. Tori gritted. Leo paid no attention to this repulsive woman and led Serena toward the villa. Serena, where is the room you mentioned where your aunts spent their childhood? He asked. It's over there. Let me show you. Serena held Leo's hand and headed towards the room from her childhood memories. Having been left unattended for many years, the villa felt cold and abandoned. Thick layers of dust covered everything. Leo silently prayed that no one had disturbed his mother's belongings, hoping to find some clues. They pushed open the door, which had been sealed for a long time, and the room was filled with dust. Serena said, This is it, but I'm not sure if it belonged to my older aunt or younger aunt. The room still retained its original appearance. Leo walked in, his emotions swirling inside him. Serena opened the window, allowing fresh air to circulate. This room was special, not because of its grandeur, but because it exuded a playful atmosphere. Various handicrafts adorned the space, giving it a unique charm. The desk was cluttered with books, and a picture frame displayed a photo of the two of them together. Several other individual photos were placed beside it, capturing a vibrant and spirited woman, Leo's mother. Leo picked up the photo frame and gently wiped away the thick layer of dust. The woman in the photo looked just like the one engraved on the tombstone. Leo's emotions were in turmoil. Serena didn't notice his peculiar behavior as she was busy examining the small items. Leo ran his fingers over the books, even though they stained his fingers with dust. This was where his mother used to live. His gaze landed on a photo album. Opening it, he found mostly pictures of his mother and her sister. Despite her sister's composed and steady demeanor, the photos depicted a strong bond between them. From a young age, Leo could sense their close relationship through the photographs. If they shared such a strong bond, then why did the image of his aunt mistreating her arise? According to Edmund Barclay, his mother was pregnant when she came back from Europe and faced backlash from the Jenner family before she moved out. In other words, she must have stayed at home for a period of time upon her return. Could she have left any clues about his father during that time? Leo, what are you looking for? Serena asked as she snapped out of her thoughts and realized that Leo was searching through the cabinets. Serena, help me find something like a diary, Leo said. Serena also joined in the search. Laura seemed to enjoy drawing, but they couldn't find a diary. Instead, they discovered numerous sketches. Leo carefully examined each one until he selected a few drawings. There was a peculiar symbol on them. Serena, do you recognize the symbol? He asked. Serena shook her head. I don't know. Maybe Aunt designed it for someone else? It looks like some kind of logo to me, she muttered. No, logos usually have variations and different versions. But these drafts only have one consistent pattern, as if it was meant for someone particular, Leo explained. If it's not a logo, could it be a tattoo or something? Serena suggested. Tattoo? Leo took a picture of the symbol with his phone. He had a hunch that this symbol held great importance. It could be a special emblem, maybe. Why would Aunt draw so many of them? Serena wondered aloud. Serena, let's keep searching for other clues, Leo urged. He was determined to find something today. They searched diligently but found nothing. Leo, it seems like there's nothing particularly significant here. Leo gazed at the pile of handicrafts. Some were cloth dolls, while others were made of wool. Perhaps these were made during his mother's leisure time while she was pregnant. Take another look at those items, he suggested. All right, Serena nodded. Some of the items were placed on a high shelf, requiring Serena to stand on her tiptoes to reach them. Be careful, Peach, Leo cautioned, concerned for her safety. I will. Serena had barely finished speaking when she lost her balance the next moment. Along with her stumble, something fell. It was a crystal ball commonly seen in the streets and shops. She heard the sound of porcelain shattering as the base of the crystal ball broke. "Leo, I didn't do it on purpose," Serena quickly apologized. Leo helped her up. "Are you okay? Did you get hurt?" he asked. Serena shook her head. "No, no. I think something fell out." Serena's eyes caught sight of something, and she retrieved a ring from the shattered fragments. "This gemstone ring is absolutely stunning." The cat's eye green gemstone was exceptionally authentic, and the material used to adorn the gemstone seemed quite expensive. With just one glance, it was evident that this ring was far from ordinary. It boasted intricate and delicate patterns. Carved into the inner circle of the ring were the letters Smith. Edmund Barclay had recalled that his mother had mentioned this name in passing. He speculated that it might be his father's surname. Could this ring potentially belong to his father? Leo's excitement grew as he held the ring. It could potentially be the only clue he had about his father. Observing Leo's elated expression, Serena couldn't help but feel puzzled. "Leo, do you recognize this ring? What happened? What are you not telling me? Why are you so happy?" she asked. "It's a very rare gemstone." Leo quickly came up with an excuse. Serena's gaze shifted to the picture frame behind him. She wondered if it was just her imagination, but she felt that Leo's smile resembled the person in the photo, but that couldn't be possible. How could Leo resemble the person in the photo? Leo carefully stored the ring and tidied up the room. Then, he took Serena's hand and led her out. He had a strong intuition that this ring held significant importance. Why did his mother hide it so meticulously? Could it be a symbol of love between his parents? Leo wasted no time and arranged for someone to investigate the ring's origin and the significance of the unique symbol engraved on it. During their journey back, Serena couldn't shake off the feeling that Leo was acting differently. She was sure he was hiding something. Tori returned home in a fit of anger, and Gwen noticed her unusual state. Concerned, Gwen approached her and asked, "Mom, what happened? Why are you so furious?" Tori grumbled, "That wretched Serena has pushed me to the edge." Gwen looked puzzled. "But didn't you go to sell the Jenner family mansion with Dad?" "When did you meet Serena again?" she queried. "Who knows how she found out about our plan to sell the mansion? She came there purposely to create a nuisance with her husband," Tori snarled. "Mom, why would she do that? Serena has already left the Jenner family. The family's fortune is no longer her concern," Gwen snapped. With the Jenner family facing financial difficulties, she was determined not to let anyone take a single cent of their wealth. Tori vented her frustrations to Gwen, recounting the events involving Serena and Leo at the Jenner family mansion. When Gwen heard that they incurred a loss of $5 million, her anger flared up. "This Leo guy is unbelievable. He ensured that an outsider was benefited instead of us." She further added, "Mom, Serena thinks she can show off just because she found someone so powerful to support her, but I won't let her get away with it." "Gwen, don't do anything foolish. You're carrying Mark's child right now. You are supposed to marry him soon. Leo genuinely loves Serena and is very protective of her. Haven't you already provoked Leo by meddling with Serena? It's better not to do it again," Tori pleaded. Gwen was too arrogant to understand. "Mom, don't worry, I know what I'm doing," Tori questioned. "By the way, how are Mark and that scheming woman? You're supposed to get married in a few days. Have you thought about how you will handle her?" Gwen shook her head. "Not yet. I'm confused right now. Mark said he wants a paternity test done on the child. Now I don't know what to do." Tori's expression changed upon hearing this. "Gwen, tell me the truth. Are you actually pregnant with his child? Did you lie to Mark and all of us?" she questioned. Gwen protested, "Mom, actually, I am not pregnant at all. I had no other choice. Once we slept together, I had a very small window to come up with this plan. If I didn't seize the opportunity, how could I have a chance to marry into the Barclay family?" Tori was flustered at her daughter's foolishness. "You're playing a dangerous game. You can hide such a thing for a day or two, but not forever. If the Barclay family finds out you're lying, you'll be in big trouble. Mom, you don't understand. Although I wasn't pregnant that night, It doesn't mean I won't have a chance to be in the future. It may be fake now, but not later. Gwen had already made her plans. Tori had underestimated Gwen, thinking she was just a spoiled girl. Now she realized her mistake. Gwen was cunning and also exceptionally shrewd. "You're taking a huge risk. If you fail, what will you do?" Tori asked and sighed helplessly. Gwen's actions were a gamble. If she lost, she would lose everything. But if she won, she would secure a life of luxury. "I won't fail. If I can deceive Mark once, then I can deceive him a second time. Once I have a child, Mark won't be able to turn away from me. The child will become my leverage. Then what can Haley use to compete with me?" Gwen didn't care about Haley, who lacked a prestigious family background and couldn't conceive a child. In Gwen's eyes, Haley was just a fleeting annoyance. Gwen had already hired a private detective to investigate, confident that she would uncover something about Haley. "Mom, just watch. I will handle everything." Among all the women, Gwen despised Serena the most. Her gut told her that Mark had feelings for Serena. That night on the cruise, when she had gotten intimate with Mark, she realized it. The passion with which Mark made love to her was only under the assumption that she was Serena. If she was right, then Serena was actually her biggest obstacle. As Mark's wedding approached, the media focused their attention on the event. It seemed like a done deal, and Gwen was excited. On the weekend, Serena and Leo enjoyed a rare free day together. "Leo, should we buy something special for Mark's wedding?" Serena asked as she trimmed the flowers and arranged them. Leo sat in the living room, engrossed in his laptop. The couple enjoyed a romantic and warm atmosphere, just like any other married couple. "No need. We can give him something special when he gets married to someone else in the future," Leo replied without even lifting his head. Serena was a bit bewildered. "Leo, how can you say that? This is his first marriage, so shouldn't we celebrate it?" "He won't stay married to Gwen for long." Leo had already predicted the outcome. "Why?" "Love can grow over time. Maybe they'll gradually fall in love with each other. Besides, they are going to have a child together," Serena stated. "Silly. Men aren't as simple as you think. Mark doesn't love Gwen. He agreed to marry her just to divert negative public opinion. With Gwen's personality, no man would be attracted to her, let alone someone she manipulated. Mark is a smart man. I am sure that he will find a way to get out of the situation," Leo replied. Serena nodded thoughtfully. "So, are you saying they will eventually get divorced?" she queried. Leo nodded. "That's inevitable. It's just a matter of time. Serena, come and take a look. Which color theme do you think suits our wedding?" he asked. Serena set down the flowers and walked over to Leo's side. She initially thought he was browsing stocks or something similar, but to her surprise, he was actually looking at wedding ideas. "White is always a classic color, symbolizing purity and romance. Should white be the main color?" Serena glanced at Leo's computer, where she saw at least 10 different wedding color palettes. Leo was determined to assemble the best team in the country to create the most romantic and unforgettable wedding for Serena. "Then let's go with white." Leo zoomed in on the picture. "Take a look at the concept. Let me know if there's anything you don't like, from the decorations to the menu. I'll have it changed immediately." The plan was meticulously detailed, even specifying the number of flowers for each location. "Leo, how much would it cost if we used real flowers for everything?" Serena asked while browsing through the pictures. Leo chided, "I've told you not to worry about money. We only have one wedding." He emphasized the need for proper arrangements. "You just need to tell me what you like or don't like." Serena blinked and nodded. "All right then. I've scheduled a wedding photo shoot for next week. I initially wanted to go abroad for the photos, but the company has been extremely busy lately, and I had to clear my schedule for our honeymoon. Let's just have a temporary photo shoot for now. We can take a proper set of photos when we go on our honeymoon overseas." Serena understood how busy he had been recently. It warmed her heart to know that he was already preparing for their honeymoon. "I wonder what our baby will look like," Serena revealed her desire as she saw Leo's gentle face. She imagined their child would be incredibly adorable. Leo's expression changed. "Why do you want a baby?" he asked. Serena explained, In the past, I was afraid of getting pregnant because I felt our relationship wasn't stable and revealing my identity would complicate things. I worried that having a baby would add more challenges. But now I can't wait to get pregnant. She believed that having a child would bring more happiness to their family. Leo struggled to remain composed. How could he explain to Serena that they couldn't have a baby at the moment? He still hadn't disclosed the fact that they were cousins, and the child born to them might have complications or a genetic disorder. But how would he convince Serena? "Serena, we're still young. Can we hold off on having a child for now?" Leo phrased it delicately. "Why? Now that we're married, wouldn't it be wonderful to start a family?" Serena urged. Leo shook his head. Why didn't he want a baby? He yearned to have an adorable child like Serena. It would be wonderful. "I just want to spend more time with you. If we have a baby, we'll have to divide our love and attention. That's why I'd prefer to wait a little longer." However, he couldn't guarantee that a child conceived at this point wouldn't have any genetic complications. It would be ideal if everything went smoothly. But what if there were complications? How would he face Serena and their child? "Leo, you're being a bit childish. Let's consider having a child next year." Serena didn't notice the sigh of relief that escaped Leo's lips. Mark's wedding preparations were underway, causing Haley to feel anxious. She had spent countless days pondering different approaches, but little did she know that she couldn't change Mark's mind. Deep down, Haley was fully aware that Gwen could never replace Serena. But Gwen was manipulative and cunning, and once she married Mark and became Mrs. Barclay, Haley would merely be a mistress. Haley urged Mark to meet her at a restaurant, and she confronted him. "Mark, are you really going to marry Gwen?" Mark pondered before answering. "Haley, I'm sorry. I know this is incredibly unfair to you, but it is happening. I don't have much choice." Mark had wanted to reveal the truth to Haley multiple times, but witnessing her tearful face always weakened his resolve, forcing him to postpone the confession. During this period, Haley's tears had practically become her constant companion. No matter how hard she tried, she couldn't alter reality. "Mark, what am I to you? Where do I stand?" she questioned. "Haley, I've kept you waiting for too long. In the past, I thought we could continue like this, but circumstances have changed from what I had foreseen. There are numerous things beyond my control. I am truly sorry for what I've put you through. Consider this my way of making it up to you." Mark pulled out a checkbook and wrote an amount on it. He handed it to Haley, saying, "You always wanted to open a store, right? Take this and start your own business. You'll have enough money for the rest of your life." "Haley, it's time you forget about me." Haley sought him out because she wanted to find a way to continue their relationship and keep him. Little did she expect that Mark was ready to sever ties with her. "Mark, what do you mean?" Haley asked, and barely glanced at the check. No matter the sum of money on that check, it couldn't compare to the status of being Mrs. Barclay. She had worked tirelessly for years to attain that position. She couldn't just give it away so easily. "Haley, let's retire to being friends in the future. If you ever need help, you can still turn to me anytime," Mark offered. Haley scoffed. "Friends? Mark, you want to be friends with me? Is this because I can't have children? Why don't we consider a surrogate or test tube baby? We can go ahead and explore that option." For years, the couple had refrained from having children due to Haley's infertility and concerns regarding her family background. Back then, Mark held immense respect and fear for Edmund Barclay, fearing that it would go against his wishes and ruin his own future. At least that's what he convinced himself. Now he began to reevaluate everything. Those external factors were merely excuses he had conjured up. If he truly loved Haley, how could he not want a child with her? They could have pursued other options a long time ago. He posed a hypothetical scenario in his mind. If Serena had been in Haley's place, would they be in the same situation today? Certainly not. For Serena, he would willingly risk his own future without hesitation. Even if Serena couldn't conceive naturally, he would exhaust all possibilities to have a baby. Even if they couldn't have children, he would go to great lengths to marry Serena. Initially, guilt and compassion had driven him into a relationship with Haley. He mistakenly believed it was love. It was only when Serena entered the picture that Mark realized his mistake. Affection or sympathy could never be transformed into true love. Whether it was Haley or Gwen, he had no intention of staying with either of them. Since the situation had escalated to this point, Mark realized he had no choice but to break up with Haley and move on. Continuing the relationship would be unfair to her, as she deserved a promising future. Shaking his head, Mark clarified, "Haley, it's not that I dislike you for being unable to conceive. You know that's not the reason. If it's not the reason, then what is it? Mark, can't we go back to how things were? I won't prevent you from marrying Gwen. I just don't want you to leave me. I can't imagine my life without you." Haley anxiously grasped Mark's hand. "Haley, this will only hold you back. You'll never have a position in my life." He was about to say something but changed his mind. Haley tore up the check and said, "Mark, let's not break up, okay? I don't care about having a position, I only want you. It's clear you don't love Gwen, am I right?" "I don't love her, but..." Mark couldn't bring himself to utter such harsh words to Haley. "It's enough that you don't love her. I know you don't want to marry her." Haley hurriedly wiped away her tears. "Mark, please don't leave me. I can't live without you." Mark sighed helplessly. Fine, he would have to handle things slowly with Haley. Seeing her in such an emotional state, he was afraid of upsetting her further. Haley held onto Mark's arm and followed closely behind him. The more she behaved like this, the more Mark couldn't bear to hurt her. He escorted her home and said, "Get some rest. Stay away from the news in the coming days." His wedding with Gwen was scheduled for tomorrow. He could already envision the headlines that would surface. With tears in her eyes, Haley pleaded, "Mark, can you stay with me tonight?" Mark's heart was burdened with guilt toward Haley. He was going to marry someone else tomorrow. Now that he understood his true feelings, he felt he had let Haley down and found himself being exceptionally considerate towards her. "All right, it's getting late. Go freshen up and get some rest. I'll sleep in the guest room tonight." Haley couldn't understand why Mark didn't want to be intimate with her, even though it was clear he didn't have feelings for Gwen. Could it really be because of Serena? The idea that Mark loved Serena was absolutely impossible to accept for Haley. It was the one thing she was unwilling to admit. When it came to Gwen, Haley knew that he was doing it because Mark felt a sense of responsibility, even if he didn't love Gwen. After all, the child was his own flesh and blood. Mark was always a principled person. As Haley pondered over this, she started to see the logic. Gwen was using this child to secure her future. Deep down, Haley felt a surge of resentment. Yet there was nothing she could do now that things had come to this point. Helplessly, Haley sighed. "All right, let me get the guest room ready for you." For now, she would follow Mark's lead and try to keep things calm. When the time came, Mark would break up with her. Mark slept in the guest room that night. He had bought this apartment for Haley, and it was the first time he had slept in the guest room. Mark wasn't able to get Serena out of his head. He recalled the moments he first met her. He turned on his phone and searched for her name, finding numerous articles about her. All the negative news about Serena had been removed from the internet, leaving only positive stories. CEO utterly devoted to his beloved wife, Mr. Damon's insane love for his wife. Every picture of Serena featured Leo, and Mark couldn't help but see Serena's gentle smile reflected in his eyes. Even though his own love life was in shambles, as long as he could bring her happiness, it would be enough. Mark didn't sleep a wink that night. He got up early in the morning as a lot of preparations had to be done. The Jenner family had requested an extravagant wedding for Gwen. Mark outright rejected Tori's request for a large sum of money. The Jenner family couldn't continue treating him like an endless source of wealth. As for the extravagance, it was merely a spectacle for the media. Gwen was elated at the thought of finally having a grand wedding. Considering the Jenner family's current standing, it was unlikely for Gwen to find a husband as influential as Mark. Concurrently, Tori kept giving Gwen advice on married life, which made her a bit impatient. "Mom, please stop pestering me. I know how to handle things. Don't worry." Gwen dressed up beautifully, but she was still a stark contrast to Serena. Mark's mood was unpredictable as he arrived at the Jenner family's residence again. Back when he had come for Serena, the Jenner family was cold and quiet, which was the complete opposite of the atmosphere today. He held flowers in his hand, and the photographers were clicking away. Gwen smiled sweetly, while Mark's face appeared solemn, as if attending a funeral rather than his own wedding. "Mr. Barclay, please smile," the photographer requested. Mark forced a smile that looked more like a grimace. After completing the formalities at the Jenner family home, Mark reached the venue of the wedding, nervous and uncertain. Gwen was escorted by her parents. Guests were already seated. Prominent figures from the business world had gathered for the occasion. Seated in the crowd, Serena and Leo observed Gwen, adorned in a white wedding dress, with a smile on her face as they exchanged vows. "Are you feeling jealous? We'll be getting married next month," Leo remarked. "I don't envy Gwen. Just by looking at Mark's expression, you can tell he doesn't want this wedding." "It's the greatest sorrow for a woman to marry someone who doesn't love her," Serena murmured and sighed. Leo playfully tapped her nose. "Silly girl, you're still thinking about it." Even though Mark knew what was ahead, he willingly jumped into the fire pit. Serena shrugged helplessly. "But if it weren't for that, we wouldn't have been able to be together, Leo." "You're absolutely right," Leo smiled, holding her tightly. On the other end of the row, Blake, watching the intimate exchange between the two, felt her heart shatter. Harry noticed the expression on her face and calmly said, "Leo and Serena will have their wedding next month." "What?" Blake was taken aback, realizing she had overreacted. She quickly tried to explain. "I'm just a little curious, that's all," Harry quipped. "Curiosity, huh? I hope that's all it is. Blake, remember this. Whether you love me or not, you are Mrs. Harry Barclay. I've given you everything. If you dare to betray me, I won't forgive you. Harry, why would I ever do something to disappoint you? I love you." Blake hastily changed her expression. "Then put a smile on your face and be prepared for what I will do to you after we get back home," Harry sneered. There was a bustling crowd of media and business people at the wedding, creating a lively atmosphere. Sandra pulled Haley aside outside the hotel and expressed her concern. "Haley, don't you think you're inviting trouble upon yourself? Mark and Gwen are getting married today, and here you are, present at the wedding venue. Why did you come?" Haley appeared exhausted, and her lack of sleep was evident. She had been constantly worried about losing Mark during this period. Their relationship was hanging by a thread, like a precarious building on the verge of collapse. "Sandra, you don't understand how I feel. I just want to see him," Haley replied wearily. "I think you should just cause a scene at their wedding, making it impossible for Gwen to proceed. You've been by Mark's side all these years." "What does Gwen even mean to him?" Sandra suggested, frustrated. Haley smiled helplessly. "Do you think I don't want to do that? But if I were to confront Gwen, it would only push Mark further away. I can't do that to him. Engaging in a fight at the wedding would only jeopardize any chances of a future with Mark." Haley couldn't bring herself to do something so foolish. "If you have made up your mind on that, let's just observe from outside the venue." "Don't go in," Sandra advised, concerned that Haley would be disturbed by the celebrations inside. "No, I want to go in," Haley insisted, tugging at Sandra's hand as they entered the hall. The wedding had just taken place, and the atmosphere inside was joyous. The host was doing his best to create a festive mood. Spotlights illuminated the newlywed couple. Haley watched as Gwen wore a smile while Mark appeared serious and distant. Mark didn't love Gwen, and she didn't love him either. The only reason was that she was with a child. Haley had to find a way to remove that obstacle. She hadn't given up on being with Mark. Although she knew that Mark didn't love Gwen, tears still streamed down Haley's face as she witnessed the couple. There was nothing more agonizing than watching the person you love marry someone else. The bride standing there wasn't her. In the midst of the music, the couple embraced each other. Haley couldn't hold back her tears and cried silently. Serena noticed Haley in the corner, her own eyes welling up with sympathy. "Leo, Haley looks so pitiful. She has to witness her beloved marrying someone else and remain hidden in the shadows for the rest of her life," Serena expressed with a hint of sorrow. Leo glanced at Haley, who was standing afar, tears streaming down her face as she covered her mouth. He showed no compassion. People who bring misfortune upon themselves deserve no sympathy. They create their own outcomes and can't blame others, Leo responded coolly. Serena momentarily forgot that, apart from his tenderness toward her, Leo had a cold attitude toward everyone else. After witnessing this, I feel that our journey to be together hasn't been easy. Leo, do you think something might go wrong at our wedding next month? Serena asked, her voice filled with worry. Don't worry, we'll be fine, Leo reassured her. When she saw Leo and Serena together, Blake felt increasingly distressed. She observed Leo, then glanced at Harry Barclay. They represented two extremes to her. After the wedding, Serena showed no intention of staying, and Leo still had numerous business matters to attend to. The two of them exchanged a few words with Mark and decided to leave. Little Hammer, Carter's voice reached Serena's ears, prompting her to turn towards him. Carter, she greeted him, recalling that he had helped her out before, although she hadn't had a chance to properly thank him. I happen to see you guys here. There are some details to be finalized for the project. Are you available this afternoon? Carter inquired. Leo's schedule for the day was packed, but Carter's project was also significant, so Leo had to make room for him. Serena understood the situation, so she took the initiative to respond. Leo is occupied. Coincidentally, I'm the one handling the project, so it would be fine for me to discuss it with you, right? If it were anyone else, Leo wouldn't be concerned about Serena going alone, but he trusted Carter's character. I have something to attend to in the afternoon. If there are any issues, you can talk to Serena, Leo replied. I understand you're busy, Mr. Damon. My afternoon is free to discuss the project. I hope you won't be jealous, Carter teased. Leo wrapped his arm around Serena's waist and interjected, Stick to discussing official matters only. I know. Don't worry, Carter assured. Leo kissed Serena passionately before letting go of her hand. If I have time, I'll come pick you up. Don't worry about me. Go ahead, Serena replied, aware that Leo was busy with a lot going on in the company and also their upcoming wedding. How long are these two going to flaunt their affection in front of me? It's only one afternoon. They can't seem to take their hands off each other. I can't stand it, Blake muttered under her breath, feeling a sense of annoyance. Carter took Serena's hand and departed without offering any explanation. Leo called after them. Carter let go of her hand. Serena covered her mouth and smiled. She sensed that Leo treated Carter similarly to how he treated Mark, with no hostility whatsoever. In a way, it seemed like the two of them had become friends. Leo's anger was merely a facade. She didn't resist when Carter held her hand as if he were her older brother. When she had been trolled by everyone at the mall, Carter had come to her defense. Carter, do you have a sister? Serena suddenly asked. Why do you ask? Carter questioned and opened the door for her. Serena smiled and said, I just feel like you're like my brother. I had this feeling when we interacted online. Whenever I share something unpleasant with you, you always comfort me, like a brother who understands my heart. You still have the audacity to bring up the past. We used to chat every few days back then. How long has it been since our last conversation? Carter feigned annoyance, and Serena couldn't help but feel a little embarrassed. Ever since she got to know Leo, she had rarely spoken with Carter. A lot has been going on recently. I haven't had much time, actually, Serena explained. Little Hammer, don't distance yourself from me just because I confessed my feelings to you. Even if we can't be romantic partners, we can still be friends. Meeting each other in various ways is a form of fate. I can't explain why, but the moment I saw you, I felt the urge to protect you. I have this unexplainable affection for you. Even if it's not a romantic love, it can still be a brother's love for his sister. I don't want to see you being treated unfairly, Carter expressed sincerely. Serena's lips curled into a gentle smile. Your sister must be very fortunate. Unfortunately, I haven't been able to find her until now. That's actually one of the reasons why I came back to the country, to search for my sister, Carter revealed. Has she gone missing? Serena inquired, not fully grasping the situation. Her situation is more complicated, and it's not easy to explain in a few words. Let's not dwell on it, Carter responded, feeling a headache creeping in at the thought of it. After all, it was a personal family matter, so Serena refrained from asking further questions. Carter and Serena left the wedding venue together, with Carter briefing Serena on the project details during the ride. This project is a collaboration between Europe and America. In addition to our companies working together, we also need to leverage Japanese technology. Interestingly, the CEO of the Japanese company is joining us. I already informed Leo about it, he explained. I've arranged for Abe Moto, the CEO of the Japanese company, to meet us at the hot springs. I didn't expect you to come along as well. I hope it's not inconvenient, Carter added. Serena nodded in understanding. No problem. The hot springs have separate sections for men and women. You can talk to Mr. Moto first, and I'll join you both with some additional details after he's done. That sounds like a good plan. You could also take the opportunity to relax in the hot springs yourself, Carter suggested. Yeah, that sounds good, Serena agreed, looking forward to a soothing soak. The car arrived at the famous hot springs, where Abe had already arrived and was waiting for Carter. Serena had imagined Abe to be older, possibly in his 40s or 50s, but she was surprised to see that he was quite young, around 30 years old. She greeted him politely. Hello, sir. I'm Serena Jenner from LD Corporation, and I'm in charge of this project. Miss Jenner, you're truly beautiful, Abe exclaimed with a twinkle in his eye as he shook hands with her. Serena was taken aback by his directness. He was still holding her hand as he said, Hello, I'm Abe. It's an honor to meet you. Serena awkwardly withdrew her hand and replied, Thank you, Carter clarified. The one originally scheduled to come today was Mr. Damon, but unfortunately, Leo had an urgent matter at the company and couldn't make it. This is Mr. Damon's assistant, who also happens to be his wife. She's in charge of the project. Assistant and wife? Abe smiled, hinting at the common perception of illicit relationships between CEOs and their assistants. Shall we go to the hot springs first? Miss Jenner will join us later for the discussion, Carter suggested. The hot springs had separate bathing areas, and Serena could hear their conversation clearly through the door. Abe made a few jokes that made Serena blush with embarrassment from time to time. She had no choice but to ignore them. Luckily, Carter was present, which made her feel more at ease. The hot spring facility had beautiful interiors, resembling a Turkish bath rather than a natural hot spring like the one she had visited before. Serena changed into her bathing attire and stepped into the hot spring, revealing her long legs as she submerged herself in the water. The water flowed through her thighs until it reached the butterfly birthmark on her waist. The temperature was perfect, and Serena felt all the fatigue in her body melt away. She thought about Leo, who was still busy at the moment. One day, she hoped to bring him here to relax in the hot springs and enjoy the same tranquility she was experiencing now. Serena then wondered about Mark and Gwen's wedding, whether the festivities were over. She couldn't help but feel sorry for Haley. Nonetheless, she tried to push the thoughts away and relaxed herself. The wedding venue was filled with a lively and crowded atmosphere. The air carried a subtle fragrance, and the sounds of guests bustling around filled the ears. Gwen changed into an elegant dress for the toast and mingled among the guests. When she saw Haley's tear-streaked face, she felt a sense of satisfaction. Despite being the one who had been by Mark's side all these years, it was time for Haley to face the reality of who the real Mrs. Barkley was. Observing Haley heading towards the restroom, Gwen decided to follow her. Haley took out a compact mirror and started to touch up her makeup, tears still on her face. Wow, you're crying quite a lot. If you felt so bad, you shouldn't have come, Gwen remarked and walked in, wearing a smug smile. Haley set down the compact mirror and looked at Gwen coldly. Do you even know where Mark was last night? He spent the entire night with me. Gwen, you may be married to Mark, but you'll never have his heart, she snapped. Gwen was taken aback by the revelation that Mark was still involved with Haley. The smile on her face disappeared. You wretched woman. Looks like you've forgotten what I said, she gritted. Gwen, you're only relying on this child. Without this child, Mark will cast you aside. No matter how glorious you appear today, you'll end up in a pitiful state, Haley commented. Gwen's anger flared, making her teeth grind. Don't celebrate already. At least I married Mark. And you? You'll be condemned to hide in a dark corner for the rest of your life without any support. Gwen, how about we make a bet and see who comes out as the winner? Haley suggested, adding more powder to her face. A bet? What do you have to bet on with me? Gwen retorted, uninterested. You'll find out soon enough, Haley said with a mysterious smile. Gwen wondered what Haley had in mind when she heard Sandra's voice in the background. Mark, Haley went to the restroom to freshen up her makeup. I saw Gwen follow her in. Do you think something might happen between the two of them? Sandra expressed her concern. Suddenly, a scream echoed through the restroom. Gwen, I didn't come here to argue with you. I just wanted to see Mark. You! Gwen witnessed Haley taking out a Swiss knife from her handbag and slitting her wrist. This woman! She was ruthless! The knife slipped from Haley's hand, and her wrist started bleeding profusely. Haley! Mark shrieked as he rushed into the restroom and saw Haley leaning against the sink. Gwen stood nearby, not far from her. A Swiss knife lay on the floor between them, and Haley's hand continued to bleed. Gwen finally realized what Haley was up to. This woman was incredibly devious. Mark, it hurts, Haley croaked and looked at Mark, tears welling up in her eyes. Mark held her tightly in his arms. Haley, did Gwen hurt you? He asked. No, I didn't. Haley did this to herself, Gwen quickly explained, waving her hands in denial. She hadn't anticipated a trap to be set by Haley. Haley deliberately showed her a sorrowful expression, knowing that Gwen, with her personality, would mock and ridicule her. Haley had intentionally lured her into the restroom to enact this devious plan. Mark already had a misconception about Gwen. Seeing this scene now, he would undoubtedly find it even harder to believe her. Are you crazy? Do you think you can deceive me like this? Gwen, I thought you were just willful and nasty, but I never expected you to be so malicious, he roared. Mark, please don't blame Gwen. It's my fault. I shouldn't have come here. I just wanted to catch a glimpse of you from afar. I didn't intend to disrupt anything. I'm sorry. It's all my fault. Today is your wedding day. Please don't be angry, Haley pleaded. The blood continued to flow from Haley's hand, creating a shocking sight that deeply hurt Mark. Haley, how are you still defending her? He murmured, a sigh escaping from his lips. Gwen was speaking with desperation. Mark, don't listen to Haley's words. She's deliberately using this dirty trick to gain your sympathy. This woman is a monster disguised in human skin. She's extremely dangerous. Please don't believe her. All you need to do is have this knife tested for fingerprints. You won't find mine on it at all. Haley clutched onto Mark's clothes and pleaded, Mark, I've already said that I don't blame Gwen. Today is your special day, so let's just let this incident go. Creating a scene will only reflect poorly on you and the Barclay family. Lately, you've faced enough negative publicity. I don't want to cause any more trouble for you because of me. Haley's words held some truth. If the media caught wind of this news at such a critical moment, they would undoubtedly report on it. Let me take you to the hospital, Mark said as he picked Haley up and left. Although Mark didn't express too much anger towards Gwen, Gwen knew that he now held nothing but disdain for her. Damn, Haley. She had calculated that Mark wouldn't make a big fuss and wouldn't dig deeper into the matter. That was why she was so confident. This woman was even more cunning than Gwen had anticipated. Mark had always held a prejudice against her, and after this incident, his hatred had deepened. Sandra watched Haley's departure and sighed inwardly. Was this how low one would stoop in the name of love, deliberately causing such chaos? Mark, carrying Haley, left through the back exit. Hang in there, Haley. We'll be at the hospital soon. Mark, I'm sorry. I've caused you so much trouble. I didn't mean for this to happen. I just wanted to see you. Haley had been crying for a long time. Her eyes were red and her makeup had smudged. Her pale face looked pitiful. She appeared different from her usual self. Haley hadn't applied heavy makeup today, which only added to the sense of pity. Haley, it's not your fault. It's all Gwen's doing, Mark replied, and carefully settled her in the passenger seat. He drove Haley to the hospital and ensured that she was treated and out of danger. He felt guilty and took good care of her. Meanwhile, Gwen remained alone in an empty room, seething with anger. The war between the two women had quietly begun. Haley couldn't bear to witness Mark marrying Gwen, but causing a scene at the wedding wouldn't benefit anyone. In the end, she believed that resorting to a bitter scheme was her best chance to get Mark back on her side. Mark had taken Haley to the hospital to treat her wound, and the tenderness she felt from him was something she hadn't experienced in a while. Troubling thoughts had crossed her mind during the previous night when Mark had slept in the guest room. As she suspected, her plan had worked. She had succeeded. Mark must now harbor deep resentment towards Gwen. Unaware of the ongoing grudges between Haley and Gwen, Serena was blissfully enjoying herself in the hot spring, lazily stretching her body. After a rejuvenating soak, all her fatigue seemed to vanish. She retrieved her clothes and changed into them. She went out to join Abe and Carter. She and Abe had engaged in quite a conversation. As Abe gazed at Serena, who was immersed in her thoughts, he blushed. "Miss Jenner, would you like to have dinner with me tonight?" he asked. "It would be my pleasure," Serena replied and looked at Carter. As long as he was by her side, she felt an inexplicable sense of security. After an afternoon of negotiations, the collaboration was more or less settled. Serena sighed with relief, finally achieving some progress. She called Leo to invite him for dinner, but he had to work overtime that night. Serena had no choice but to proceed with the dinner arrangement with Carter. Abe had invited a group of his friends who had come along from Japan. Serena was the only woman at the dinner, making her the center of attention for toasts. Carter helped Serena fend off a lot of alcohol. Surprisingly, the group of people had a high tolerance for liquor. "Miss Jenner, you must take good care of us in the future. Let's raise a toast and finish this glass." "Serena doesn't handle alcohol well. I'll drink on her behalf," proposed Carter. "Carter, be a sport. Miss Jenner clearly knows how to handle her drinks," Abe murmured with a smirk. Serena noticed that Carter was already drunk. Even if he had a high alcohol tolerance, it would be challenging to handle so many toasts. "Carter, you don't have to drink. I can manage on my own." She couldn't bear to see him suffer on her behalf. "Do you really think so?" Carter questioned. Serena nodded in agreement, saying, "Yes, I can." With determination, she raised her head and took a sip of the wine. Everyone's gaze turned intense. "Miss Jenner, you must finish this glass of wine. In the future, our companies may have opportunities for greater prospects." Serena shook her head, saying, "I really can't drink anymore." She and Carter had already reached their limit. Any further drinking would only result in getting drunk. "Are you insulting me, Miss Jenner?" asked one of Abe's friends. "That's not what I meant," Serena muttered. "If not, then finish the wine," he commanded. "Don't worry, I'll join you in drinking." Leo's voice came from beside Serena, and a smile formed at the corner of her mouth. Leo had just finished his work and hurried over. Seeing the wine bottles on the table, he knew they had already consumed a lot. Serena's eyes showed signs of intoxication from drinking with Carter. "And who might you be?" Abe asked, looking at the man who had suddenly appeared. "Allow me to introduce myself. I'm Leo Damon, and I'm also a partner in this project." "I thought I should join this fun party," Leo announced. He had already seen them forcing Serena to drink, which had made him furious. He gestured to the waiter to bring over 8 bottles of red wine. Serena was taken aback by this unexpected turn. "Leo, what are you doing?" she queried. Leo opened a bottle for each of them. Abe and the others were left speechless. These were bottles of red wine, not beer. How could one finish a whole bottle of red wine? "Mr. Damon, I think there's a misunderstanding. This is red wine, not beer." "Wine or beer? How does it matter?" Leo was quite confident. The guests were all startled by this. After a round of drinking, Leo remained unfazed. They had already consumed quite a bit, and they were losing their sanity. Everyone was scattered and making a riot in all directions. Leo didn't let them off easily. Leo then settled the bill. Worried, he glanced at Serena. "Are you okay, Peach?" he questioned. Serena remained composed and replied, "Yes, I'm fine. Carter helped me handle a lot of wine tonight." Carter was already inebriated. Leo looked at him and said, "Seems like he's quite drunk. Let him stay at our place tonight." "Oh, Leo, thank God you're here," Carter slurred, leaning back on his chair and heaving a sigh of relief. Carter managed to hold on until Leo arrived. If he had been drunk, who would have protected Serena? Leo instructed someone to help Carter to the car and followed behind, holding Serena closely. Serena was still conscious. "The person who came today is Abe Modo. We need to merge with Japanese technology. His family holds a significant position in Japan, so Carter didn't want to offend him." Leo nodded thoughtfully. "Does this mean that Abe holds considerable power?" he asked. Serena continued, "He's part of a family business. Japan has a highly developed economy. The Modo family possesses core technology and holds a prominent global position. Moreover, his mother's side of the family wields significant influence. It's best not to make enemies with such people. Understood?" Leo nodded. No wonder Carter had shown such patience with Abe. It was better to be friends than enemies. In the back seat, Carter was already heavily intoxicated. He wouldn't usually drink this much. He had done it all for Serena. After instructing the maid to prepare a guest room for Carter, Leo helped him onto the bed. Serena started to take off his shoes. Leo turned around and noticed her action, furrowing his brows. "Let the maid handle that." Leo usually wouldn't even allow Serena to do such tasks for him. "Leo, don't misunderstand. I feel like he's my older brother. He took care of me at the mall, and today he protected me from drinking too much," Serena explained. Leo shook his head. "Regardless of what you feel, even if he was really your big brother or anything else, feel that you don't have the need to take on these tasks." Leo pulled her up and bent down to remove Carter's other shoe. "Leo, wait." Serena didn't expect him to follow suit. Leo removed his coat and instructed, "Serena, go get a hot towel. I'll wipe his face." "Okay." Serena got a towel and hot water and handed them to Leo. He carefully wiped Carter's face and hands. He loosened his tie and covered Carter with the blanket before pulling Serena away. In reality, Leo too had consumed quite a lot of alcohol tonight, far more than Serena. However, he managed to maintain his composure. "What happened, Peach? Why are you looking at me like that?" Leo gently asked. "Leo, you handle alcohol really well. Who used to take care of you earlier when you were drunk?" Serena asked and looked at Leo with sympathy. She hadn't forgotten that Leo had left the Barclay family to start on his own. All of his businesses were built from scratch. Even if she hadn't witnessed it firsthand, she knew how challenging it was to start a business. "I don't need anyone to take care of me. I can take care of myself," Leo remarked. It wasn't as simple as he made it sound. There had been instances when he had vomited multiple times and ended up unconscious. But what could he do? He had to work hard to climb up the ladder. Apart from his exceptional skills, he had to learn how to handle things for others. Sometimes during business negotiations, he had to drink until he almost had to throw up. "From now on, I'll take care of you when you get drunk, Leo," Serena announced and sweetly smiled. "You didn't drink too much tonight, did you?" Leo questioned. Serena shook her head. "Not too much. I was able to limit my intake. I'm glad you're not drunk. From now on, I won't let you attend dinners alone." Leo ended up drinking more than usual, but he pretended to be fine. Serena guided him to bed. "Leo, are you okay? Let me take care of you." She knelt to remove Leo's shoes and socks, then grabbed a hot towel to gently wipe his body. Leo laid down on the bed and drifted off to sleep. It became evident that his apparent strength was merely a facade. However, it was true that Carter and Leo together had managed to outdrink seven people. They were quite resilient when it came to alcohol. Serena ensured Leo was settled before heading to the bathroom for a bath. Emerging with a towel wrapped around her, she prepared to change into her pajamas. As she lowered the towel to her waist, she suddenly heard a surprised voice from behind her. "Butterfly birthmark. A butterfly birthmark. I've finally found her." Serena turned around and was shocked to find Carter in her bedroom. She felt scared and quickly covered herself with a towel. Wondering why Carter was standing at the door, she asked, "Carter, what are you doing here?" Approaching her, Carter whispered, "Butterfly birthmark." "Yes, I have a butterfly birthmark on my waist." "So what?" Serena thought he might be drunk and didn't want to upset him. "You're my little Grace." "I finally found you, little Grace." Carter seemed excited. Before Serena could inquire further, Carter suddenly collapsed to the ground. "Carter." Serena hurried over and realized he had fallen asleep on the carpet. Confused and helpless, she looked at him and then at the man lying on her bed. All the maids were asleep, and she didn't want to disturb them. She decided to cover Carter with a blanket and pillow from the cabinet, keeping an eye on both men throughout the night. She soon fell asleep and was awakened by Leo's kiss in the morning. With a soft moan, she opened her eyes. Trying to recall the situation, she remembered Carter was still in the room. "Leo." Serena tried to speak, but Leo's kisses interrupted her. He had lifted her nightgown, trying to initiate something intimate. "No," she managed to break free from his kiss and say something. Leo was eager. "Baby, Leo, not now." Serena resisted. Serena attempted to get up, but Leo pulled her back onto the bed, saying, "It's been 2 days, I really want to." Serena was trying to give him a hint. "I understand, but not right now." Leo frowned. "I thought your period had ended." Serena shook her head and replied, "That's not it." "Then what is it?" "Serena, please don't tell me you're losing interest in me," Leo said, looking hurt. "Guys, could you please tone down the affection in front of me?" a man's voice suddenly interjected. Leo quickly pushed Serena back under the blanket, making sure she was covered. "Carter, why are you here?" "You better explain yourself," Leo said, addressing the man that was now looking up from the foot of their bed. Leo distinctly remembered sending Carter to the guest room to sleep. "When did he end up in their room? Even I want to know." "Why am I here?" Carter replied, confident that he wasn't that drunk. Serena popped her head out from under the blanket. "Let me explain. Carter, you had too much to drink last night, so we brought you home to sleep. Leo escorted you to the guest room, but it seems you wandered in a drunken state into our room and fell asleep. I kept you down there with a blanket and a pillow, and you slept here all night." Carter fully regained his senses. "I see." Leo, clearly in a sour mood from the unexpected interruption of their morning activities, said, "You have 3 seconds to leave. The first room downstairs is the guest room." Carter quickly got up. "I apologize for the trouble last night, Mr. Damon. I'll leave now." Serena felt extremely embarrassed, her face turning red under the blanket. "Oh, how embarrassing." After Carter left, Leo pulled her out from under the blanket. "Did you really let him sleep in our bedroom all night?" he asked. Serena pouted. "Leo, everyone was asleep. There's no way I could have dragged him to the guest room. I didn't want to disturb you, so I had no choice but to let him sleep on the floor." Leo was annoyed. "What if he had seen something inappropriate?" he demanded. Serena noticed Leo's slightly red ears. "Are you shy?" she inquired. "No," Leo replied hastily, rushing to the bathroom. He had never been so embarrassed before. Serena couldn't help but cover her mouth and giggle. Leo had such an adorable side to him. She then remembered that her back was exposed, and Carter had seen her birthmark the previous night. She decided it was best not to mention it to Leo. Carter went downstairs to freshen up. He had a dream last night. In the dream, he saw the butterfly birthmark. Shaking his head, he wondered why it felt so familiar. He had been dreaming about the birthmark for a long time, but last night's dream felt incredibly vivid, as if he had seen the birthmark with his own eyes. Carter let out a soft sigh. When would he find his sister? He only had an old childhood picture and the knowledge of a butterfly birthmark on her waist to guide him. How could he locate his sister in this crowded world? People change over the years, and the baby in the photo would have grown up. Finding her wouldn't be easy. His grandfather's health was deteriorating rapidly, and his dying wish was to see his granddaughter before he passed away. Carter had come back to America specifically to search for her, but the results so far had been disappointing. It had been many years. Finding her wasn't a simple task. It was Carter's first time visiting Leo's residence, and he felt a sense of relief knowing that Leo was treating Serena well. He believed that their encounter must be fate. He had been chatting with Serena for over 2 years online, and even after he met her in person, he felt that he had known her all his life. Carter joined Serena and Leo at the table for breakfast. "Did you sleep well last night, Carter?" Serena asked, her face red. Carter had seen something he shouldn't have early in the morning, even though Serena and Leo were already married. Seeing Serena's blushing face, Carter understood and decided not to tease her. "Yes, thanks to you, I slept well." "It felt good to sleep on the floor for the first time," Carter said. Leo knew that Serena often walked barefoot on the cold floor. Seeing the weather getting colder, he had specially ordered a high-quality, thick carpet to be customized, ensuring that Serena wouldn't step on a cold floor. Serena had just made sure Carter had a blanket and pillow for him, so he didn't feel the slightest discomfort last night. "In the future, you are always welcome to my home. But sleep on the guest bed instead of the floor next time," Leo said casually. "Of course, thank you for the invite," Carter joked. "I'll stop by your house more frequently to check on Serena. I'm glad you're treating Serena well. Wasn't sure you could." Serena's face turned even redder and it looked like she was about to burst. The atmosphere, which had been fine just moments ago, suddenly turned tense. The room was filled with an awkward silence as if the two of them were on the verge of a fight. "Carter, you are an outsider. What right do you have to ask me this question?" Leo asked, his words cold. Carter, too, was speechless. He wasn't someone who spoke like that. Leo was right. What right did he have? Although he cared for Serena as if she was his younger sister, she wasn't actually his sister. "Leo, I'm hungry. Let's eat now." Serena quickly intervened to diffuse the tension. Leo immediately surrendered. Despite his domineering personality trait in the corporate world, at home, he was just a doting husband. "All right, let's eat first," Leo conceded. Carter could sense the love between them as he observed their interaction. This man truly loved Serena. He was filling up Serena's plate with food as if he was afraid that she would go hungry. Carter had originally planned to share the progress of the previous day with Leo, but seeing the sweet and affectionate moments between the two of them, he couldn't bring himself to interrupt. It felt like he had just enjoyed a sweet treat by being in the room with them. He overheard them discussing their upcoming wedding. Serena suggested, "Is it too soon to have the wedding next month?" "Not at all, I feel it's too late," Leo replied in a cold tone. "It's because of the wedding and the honeymoon. Leo has been busy lately," Serena added softly. She felt that with the mountain of work Leo had, maybe he should take a break after a month or so and then plan the wedding. She was also eagerly looking forward to starting a family with him. Both of them had never experienced much warmth in their respective families growing up. Once they had a child, they were determined to provide a loving and happy home. "I think Leo is right. There never will be a right moment, and with the way Leo's business is expanding, it will always be like this," Carter murmured. All three of them had a great breakfast. They spoke about business, weather, the upcoming wedding, and a lot of other things before going their separate ways. Carter had a lot on his plate and had been getting busier lately. Leo had his hands full with company matters, while Serena was busy with the wedding preparations.